trust in those promises, can't we? That he is going to keep his word and what he has said. Let's look at our memory verse for the week. Romans 5:10 says, "For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life." So let's read that together.
For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see all of y'all again. So in terms of announcements, looks like Tuesdays at 10 a.m., the Craft Guild will be working on quilts. Contact Debbie Burnett if you have any questions. And then July 6th, we're having a business meeting at 5:45 p.m. Do we have any other announcements? All right, let's see. Do we have any testimonies at this time? Keep quiet about it since we found out about it on Friday morning. But 50 years ago, an unrighteous ruling was made in our Supreme Court. And praise God, on Friday morning, it was overturned. And so this doesn't mean that it's over. This just means that it goes back to the state's rights. And so we have to continue preaching the gospel to everyone as we have been doing. If there's a mother who is in this situation where she's faced with this choice, we must show her love and compassion. And yet, we also must not be ashamed to preach the gospel to her. And so, I'm thankful for what God has done, and I look forward to what he plans on continuing to do in this situation. There are many people who are upset about the decision, and some of them are peacefully protesting, and I'm sure many others will not heed the warnings to do so peacefully. So just pray for the businesses that will be destroyed, the property that will be taken from others. But most of all, pray for the salvation of those who, in light of this decision, have decided that they need to show anger toward their neighbors because of it. Do we have any others? So at this time, we would like to look at our Westminster Shorter Catechism Baptist version. This week we are on question number 26. And so if you would, as we usually do, recite the answer with me after I say the question. So question number 26, how does Christ execute the office of a priest? And the answer, Christ executes the office of a priest in his once offering up of himself a sacrifice for the sins of his people to satisfy divine justice and to reconcile them to God, and in making continual intercession for them. And so our scripture references for this week, the first one is Hebrews chapter 9, verses 14 and 28. And it says, "How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God. Purge your conscience from the dead works to serve the living God. So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin, for salvation. And then Hebrews 2:17. Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. Romans 5:10, a memory verse for the week. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And finally, Hebrews chapter 7, verses 24 and 25. But he, because he continues forever, has an unchangeable priesthood. Therefore, he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he ever lives to make intercession for them. So at this time, let us sing to our high priest, who ever lives to make intercession for us.
Please stand. I'm so glad that he's making intercession for me every day. You know, if I wasn't allowed to mess up, I'd be going nowhere. So the Lord is so good to us that he loves us enough that he will intercede for his children. Let's turn to 535. 535.
Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope.
turn to page 162. Page 162.
Well, good morning. Is everybody happy today? Oh, there's three of you. That's good. So, open your Bibles, Matthew chapter 6, please. Matthew chapter 6. And while you're finding that, this next month, in July, I'm going to be teaching on Wednesday night. I had enough of my preaching on Sunday morning, so they just stuck me on Wednesday nights. Seriously, I'm going to be teaching on the series on the question of heaven. Questions like, what do we mean by heaven? You say, what do you mean? There's heaven's heaven. No, there are actually three different heavens referred to in the scripture, and our heaven, the heaven that we consider our home, actually has three different stages to it, or phases to it. So we're going to be looking at that. What does it mean? What does it mean by heaven? Now, what happens after we die? I preached 139 funerals over the years. What happens when somebody dies? Well, especially what happens when a believer dies. We're going to be looking at that. Can people in heaven see what's going on here on earth? And we're going to answer that question. Will we recognize our loved ones in heaven? And what will we do for all eternity? Are we just going to float around on a cloud playing our harps and singing in the choir? Well, we'll find out. So we're going to do that on Wednesday night. So I just thought I'd give you a little taste of what was to come. And that way you'll know to stay home if you don't and aren't interested. The last Sunday in February that I preached for you, I introduced the subject about Jesus being asked by his disciples how to teach them to pray. And we looked at that first introductory section where Jesus began to teach them to pray. And this is where we are today. So we're going to start in verse number 5. We're going to finish that sermon from then. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the street, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when you pray, enter into the closet, and when you have shut the door, pray to your Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when you pray, use not vain repetitions, as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask. I don't know if you mark your Bible, but if you do, you ought to underline that last statement. He knows what you need before you ask. Why should I ask him then? We'll find out today. And then he goes on to say, after this manner, therefore pray you, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth, or in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now we know this as the Lord's Prayer. It's identified that way, but it isn't the Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer is actually in John 17. This is a model prayer. This is a template, if you will, a pattern of prayer, and we'll jump into that more in just a second. But let's review just a minute about what Jesus did when he was asked by his disciples to teach them to pray. Where did he start? He did not start with the words. He started with a place. And he says there very clearly, he says, I want you to go, verse number 6, I want you to go home. I want you to go in a room. I want you to shut the door and talk to your Father in secret, and your Father which seeth thee in secret will reward thee openly. The problem with our prayers is that too many times they're prayers like, help me, bless me, guide me, you know, those kind of things, and they're about us. But he says before we get to the substance of prayer, before we get to the content of prayer, we need to get the right context. We need to put yourself in the right place. And where is that place? A private place, a private, quiet place where you have time and a place to shut the door, shut out the disturbances of life, the interruptions of life, and you just meet with your Father. Just get to know him. The problem is we run in so many times, or we're driving down the road, or we're going about our daily activity and something comes to our attention and we just shoot up those little, I call them popcorn prayers, you know, just boom, boom, boom. And we think that we have accomplished prayer. Well, that is a prayer, and we all can do that from time to time. But God's interested in something more from you and I when we pray. And so he tells us, get in your room, close the door, and your Father which seeth thee in secret will reward thee openly. Prayer is about establishing and developing a personal, intimate relationship with God. So, we've got that part down. The question we need to ask now is, we've gone into the room, we've shut the door, and we are trying to get to know God. What do we talk about when we're in there? What do you say? Well, this is where we find this mantra, if you will, that we call the Lord's Prayer, but it's not. It's a model prayer. He gives us a pattern, if you will. Do we have any seamstresses in the house? Anybody sew anymore? Not very many. I mean, my mother was a seamstress, and she had patterns in her files, and she had the right size and all those kind of things. This is a pattern for prayer. Let me just tell you this, and I know I'm going to hurt somebody's feelings when I say it. Jesus never intended us to pray this prayer. It was not intended for us to together say this prayer. It is a pattern for us to pray. It gives us a guide for us to pray, but it was never intended to be our prayer. It was simply to be a guide or a direction or a pattern to know how to pray when we pray. And this is what we're going to attempt, take time to spend with today. There are three critical elements to prayer, according to Jesus. If you've been in your closet, you've shut the door, you've spent some time, you put the world out there, you put your stuff back there, and you got alone with God, and you're getting to know Him, what are we going to say to Him? What does He concern Himself with? What is it that ought to concern us? Well, this is a prayer that all of us are familiar with. And so in verse 9, he sets forth the first of the three elements. He says, after this manner, therefore, pray ye. It doesn't say after these words, pray you. It says after this manner or after this pattern. Here's what you pray. Here's where you start. The first is that you acknowledge God and give Him glory. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. We need to realize that we have the honor, and it's an honor, and we have the privilege to talk to and have a relationship with the eternal God. We're not talking to our best friend on this earth. We're not talking to our husband or wife or our children. We're not talking to our boss. We're talking to the Creator God. We're talking to the God who in eternity past looked at you and chose you to be one of His children. The eternal God who gave in time and space His unique Son, Jesus Christ, the God-man, perfectly man, sinless man, and holy God in one person to come to this earth and to take your sins and mine and go to the cross and die in our place. That's the God that we need to get to know. It's sad to me to see people who have made a profession of faith, have expressed faith in God, who have come to church most of their life, but really don't know the Lord very well. They don't know much about God. And we know that that's true because any kind of pressure, any kinds of trouble, any kinds of circumstances that come into their life negatively, they fall apart. Well, folks, we should not fall apart in the face of difficult circumstances because we belong to the Creator God, the Eternal God, the All-Powerful God, the All-Knowing God. And the better you get to know Him, the stronger your faith will be, and the more stable your life will be, no matter what circumstances happen day by day. So He tells us to start. Now notice the name that He tells us to call Him. How do we identify Him? I don't know about you, but I've heard some guys, people pray in publicly, and they start, you know, oh, great Creator God who rules the universe, who commands millions of angels and holds the stars into place, and, you know, but that's not where He tells us to start. What does He tell us to call Him? Somebody tell me, what does He say? Our Father. He said, I want you to understand that I'm like your Father. I am your Father. I'm your spiritual, eternal Father, a Father that loves, a Father that cares, a Father that provides. I want you to talk to me as your heavenly Father. He's telling us prayer doesn't start with us. He wants it to start with Him. He wants us to take our time to begin to understand who He is and who we are in relationship to Him. Because the better, here's the reason, the better we understand who He is, the better we understand who we are. Who better to tell us why we do what we do? I don't know about you, but I get frustrated with myself often. I do things I shouldn't do. Paul says in Romans 7, the things I know I should do, I don't do. The things I know I shouldn't do, I do. Oh, wretched man that I am. I can identify with that. And I say, why is it? Why do I do that? Why do I act that way? Our Heavenly Father knows. He put me together. He put you together. Now, I know that we would all sometimes wish that we could be somebody else, but God didn't make us to be somebody else. He made us to be who we are. I remember as a young preacher, when I first started out, 17 years old, every evangelist that came to our church, I tried to be like them. And every pastor that I heard that I thought was a good preacher, I tried to be like him. And I finally, a good man and a godly minister one time told me when I was just starting in the ministry, or had my first church, he says, listen, God didn't make you to be, you know, Jack Hiles. He didn't make you to be Adrian Rogers. He made you to be you. You just let God make you who you are. And when I get to know who He is, then I can better understand who I am and who He made me to be. And when we come to understand who God is, and then we understand who we are in the light of who He is and who He created us to be, we can understand better why we're here. We're not just here to spend time. We're not here just to fill up space. We're not here just to earn a living and just make it to the end somehow. God put us here for a divine purpose. And so when we spend time getting to know Him, the better we understand God's love, God's power, God's grace, God's mercy, God's holiness, the salvation that He's done for us, the less we are concerned with the affairs of life. Because we know who's in charge. We know who's in control. We know who we belong to and who cares about us. God is in heaven, and He is controlling and running everything. If you'll just move with me to the little book of Job. I know we're going to be back here at Matthew in a minute, but I want just to go over to Job. Y'all know the story of Job. Job was one of a righteous man. He eschewed evil, and he feared God. And Job lived probably way up close to the front of Scripture, even though the book of Job comes a little bit in the middle of the Old Testament. But Job was an ancient man, a righteous man. And we know the story, what happened, and the devil showed up, and God said, have you considered my servant Job? And he said, yeah. And he said, if God, if you'll just let me touch him, he said, he only serves you because you bless him. So God gave him permission, and he ends up, he loses his family, and he loses his possessions, and then he loses his health and his wife. When I get to heaven, I want to find out, why God, why did you leave his wife? Why don't you take her too? And she says, why don't you just curse God and die? And he says, the Lord gave, the Lord blessed, took and takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. How could he do that? Because he knew his God. He spent time with his God, and he didn't have the New Testament. He didn't have the Old Testament, but he spent time in relationship building with his God. But here in the end of Job, at the book of Job, and a lot of people don't even know about the end of the book of Job. They read the first part, but in chapter 38 of Job, Job begins to complain a little bit. He's had to deal from the early chapters to this chapter, he's had to deal with the friends, not so friendly, that have come to him and told him, said, Job, we know the whole problem's you. If you just confess your sin, this would be over with. And Job said, but I didn't sin. I didn't do anything to cause this. And he's getting tired of it. And he's getting a little bitter at God. And so Job begins to question him, if you will. He begins to question God. And notice verse 1, chapter 38. The Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that darkeneth counsel by words without knowledge. Gird up now thy loins like a man, for I will demand of thee, and you have to answer me. So Job, who are you to count? You said, the Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Although you slay me, I will trust him. Way back over there. Now, what's happened? And so he begins to ask Job questions. He said, where was thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Were you present when I put this earth together? He said, who laid the measures thereof, or thou knowest, or who has stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations fastened? Who laid the cornerstone thereof? When the morning stars sang together and the sons of God shouted for joy, or who shut up the sea with doors when it broke forth as if it issued out of the womb? He's saying this. He said, Job, I put this place together. Do you know how that works? Do you know how the boundaries of the sea are set? Who set them? Do you know how that works, Job? Now, what was he doing? He was simply doing this. Job, you don't know me as well as you think you do. And so he begins to question Job, and he questions him more over in chapter 40. Now jump over to chapter 42 of Job. This is what Job finally does after listening to God put him on the spot. Job answered the Lord, verse 1, chapter 42. It says, notice what he said? I know that thou canst do everything, and that no thought can be withholden from thee. Who is he that hideth counsel without knowledge? Therefore have I uttered that I understood not, things too wonderful for me, which I knew not. Hear, I beseech thee, and I will speak. I will demand of thee and declare it unto me. Here's the word, right here, verse 5. I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now my eyes seeth thee. Therefore, I abhor myself and repent. You see, we hear about God every Sunday. Most of you have been in church for years and years, and you know the Lord. You've got your salvation. You know you're saved. You know you're on the way to heaven. You come to church, Sunday school, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday nights. You listen to it. We've all been bombarded with the Word of God. But when we really hear it, has it caused us to know who our God is? This is what he's talking about back in Matthew. Go back over there. This is what he's talking about. You get in that room, close that door, and you spend some time with your Father. Get to know your Heavenly Father. Remind yourself who you are talking to. You're not talking to a spiritual Santa Claus that's waiting for your list to dole out your gifts. You're talking about to your Heavenly Father. And the better you know him, the more peace that you'll have. The better you know him, the different kinds of questions that you'll be asking, the different way that you'll look at life. Now let me just suggest this to you. Before you move to step 2 and step 3, give this point some time. Don't just rush in and just say, God, we love you, you're wonderful, you're omnipotent, you're powerful, you're good, you know, nice, amen. All right, here's my list. Give this some time. How do I do that? Well, I bought a couple of books just to recommend. This is a little devotional book by Henry Blackaby and his son called Experiencing God Day by Day. There's 365 devotions in here. And each one of them has the goal in mind of helping you to see God better, understand God better. Get your book. Use it. Let God use it in your life. And then talk to God about it. Before you talk to him about your car, before you talk to him about your groceries, before you talk to him about your job, before you talk to him about your pains, talk to him about him. Here's another book that's a great book. It's called God As He Longs for You to Know Him by Chip Ingram. It's a tremendous book. And he just goes over a number of the qualities, the eternal qualities of God. The better you know him, listen to me, folks, the better we know him, the less fear we'll have, the less frustration we'll have, the less worry we'll have. But you got to start and give him time. You got to get to know him. That's the first step. First step is getting to know your Heavenly Father. Back to Matthew 6, verse number 10. Anybody here like speed bumps in the parking lot? I don't. You like them? Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. You're driving along, and they're getting higher. I don't know, or I'm getting older. I don't know what it is. They're getting worse. We come to a speed bump in prayer. This is verse number 10. We started off wonderful. We're getting to know God. We're understanding who he is. We understand what he does. We understand who we are in relationship to him. Man, that's a great start. But now we have to do something. In the light of who God is, in the light of what we know about him, in the light of the knowledge that we have received by spending time with him and praying to him and getting to know him, here's what he wants you and I to do. Verse 10. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. This is why God puts us on the earth. We get to know him so that we might be the agents of carrying out his will on this earth. In government, in marriage, in our jobs, in our churches. The reason I call it a speed bump is that most of us aren't willing to do this. We'll give God 2 hours on Sunday morning. We'll give God an hour on Wednesday night. We'll give God a few minutes to read the Bible to our children or have prayer with them. But we say, okay, God, this is your part, and the rest is mine, and it isn't yours, and it isn't mine. It belongs to him. But until we're willing to take our whole life, our treasure, our marriages, our careers, our children, and say, God, your kingdom come, your will be done. I surrender all. Until we can sing that song, all to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. We sing it, but I'm going to tell you, we don't always mean it. This is the hard part. This is the hardest part because we have our will. We're willful individuals. We want to control our lives. We want to make our own decisions. We want to determine our destiny. It's all about us. No, it's not about us. It's about him. We do not belong to ourselves. We have been bought with a price. We have been redeemed by him, paid for by the blood of Christ from the slave market of sin. We don't belong to ourselves anymore. We belong to him. And until we're willing to say, here I am, I present myself. Paul put it this way in Romans 12, 1 and 2. He said, I beseech you, I beg you, I plead with you, my brothers, that you present yourself. You have to do it. It's your will. God's not going to wrestle your life from your hands. He's not going to wrestle your family from your hands. He's not going to pry your hands open and take it from you. He wants you and I to give it to him willingly. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the will of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice. Holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. It's not unreasonable. And be not conformed to this world, but be you transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God. This is the tough part. This is a process, by the way. You can come here this morning and kneel at this altar and say, okay, God, I'm giving you all of me. And before you get home, you've taken some of it back. If not then, by the time you get home, something comes back. How many times have I gone to the altar and say, God, this is it, I'm giving it to you. And then my wife and I get in a fuss on the way home. Or I go to work the next day and my boss gets on my case. This is a process. But this is the key process. Once you get to know who God is and you can trust Him, then He wants you to take yourself, everything, your time, talent, and treasures, and say, here it is. Here it is. You say, that's scary. Listen, it's not scary if you know the one you're giving it to. It's not scary if you understand who your God is and who, how much He loves you and what He's done for you and what He has a plan for your life. It's not scary. The scary part is that we don't want to lose control. We don't want to turn over the control of our life. And so we try to hold it all, which is silly and foolish. Remember Jesus in the garden when He prayed? He prayed with the disciples waiting, and He prayed about that death that was to come, and He said, if it be possible, listen, this is the Son of God, the very Son of God, Jesus Christ, if it be possible, let this cup pass me. What's that cup? It's the cup of God's wrath. It's a cup of sin and the vileness and the judgment of sin. And He has to take that cup and drink it. And He says, my man side, my human side, doesn't want to do that. But He kept praying until He could say these words, but not my will, but thine be done. That's what the second part of prayer should be about. Okay, well, when do I get my stuff? when do I get to tell Him what I need? Well, this is the third part in verse 11 to 13. There are three parts here. He tells us that we are dependent on Him. We acknowledge our dependency. How so? Verse 11. Give us this day our daily bread. It reminds us that we are dependent upon God every day. I don't care how much money you have in the bank. I don't care how good a job that you have. I don't care how smart you are. I don't care how many degrees that you have. You are dependent on God every single day. Back in February, my wife was walking through the house and she just her leg gave way and she reached over and was able to grab a piece of furniture to hold her up. I said, what happened? She said, I don't know, my left leg gave away. I said, well, I'm gonna get your cane. So I went and got her cane. She walked with the cane for a few days, but her leg was giving out so bad that she couldn't walk with the cane anymore, so we got a walker. She walked with the walker for a few more days, but she couldn't walk with the walker because her leg was giving out. And for almost 5 months, she's been in a wheelchair. Just like that. No accident. God just says, you're not walking for a while. Do you know how fast God can take your life away? Take your resources away? God, I am dependent upon you for the very basics of life, breathing in and out, having food on my table, having the strength in my body to do what I need to do. I'm dependent upon you. I'm dependent upon you not only for provision, but I'm dependent upon you for pardon. It says in verse number 12, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. If God doesn't forgive you, you're going to hell. Plain and simple. We are hopeless. The people that you see in our world, in our small community, I was in Columbus here a couple of weeks ago, and there's a million people up there, millions of people up there. And I watch, and they're driving down the highways, and they're passing me on the highway, and going and coming and going and coming, and went to the hospital, and there was people going and coming. And every single one of them are sinners, indebted to God. And unless they have a relationship with Jesus Christ, they're going to hell. We are dependent upon Him for pardon. We need your help, Lord. We need your forgiveness. And once we have your forgiveness, we need your help to forgive others. Because that's part of the deal. That's what He says. not only forgive us our debts, but forgive us our debts as we forgive those who sinned against us. I don't know about you, but that's pretty heavy stuff. He says, be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. That's Ephesians 4:32. How do we do that? Naturally, we don't. We want to get our vengeance. Somebody sins against us, somebody hurts against us, somebody says against us, and we want to get back. We're going to show them. God says, no. You need to remember what I've forgiven you of. How much? Everything. In like way, you forgive others. You pray for pardon. Forgive us our debts. And then finally, he says in verse 13, and lead us not into temptation. We need God's protection. We need God's protection. Protection from evil, protection from sin, protection from the world, protection from the enemy. God, protect my heart. Do you know how easy it is for the enemy and how subtle it is to give you false reasoning and false understanding and create wrong responses because you have no filter? God, protect my heart. Protect it from false teaching and false ways. Protect my family, God. My wife and I have two daughters and one granddaughter. They live both down in Virginia. And we've been praying especially for our granddaughter. She's 13, tough age. And she's gotten some wrong habits. She made a profession of faith a number of years ago. We've been praying. We talk to her when we can, but we've been praying for our God to protect her, to work in her heart, to do what we can't do. We pray for that. Protect us. Protect my marriage. Divorce among Christians. It's almost 50%. That means half of every one of them get married, get their divorce. What's that saying about our Christian faith? We need protection. If I make it till Wednesday, my wife and I will be married 49 years. They weren't always easy. There were some tough times, some challenging times. Why? Because we stepped outside of God's will. I stepped outside of God's will. We need protection. And where do we get it from? The only one that can really protect us is our Heavenly Father. So this is the prayer. This is the pattern. You start with God, and then you go to the speed bump. Not my will, but thy will be done. And then we go to, this is what we need. But the beautiful thing is he already knows what we need. And the middle is the real issue. Whose will? Whose agenda? Who's going to run things? Who's going to call the shots in your life? And I dare say this morning, even with the number that we have, that some of you are still trying to decide that. Still trying to decide. Okay, God, I love you. I know you. You've saved me. I'm a Christian. I'm going to heaven when I die. But until I get there, I'm in charge. You're missing out. You're missing out. The joy comes when we surrender all. Not my will, but thine be done. Oh my goodness, what peace, what joy, what satisfaction life takes on when we learn to pray this model prayer. Let's pray together. Lord, I can talk this pretty easily this morning. I struggle to practice it just like everybody else here. I want your will as long as it matches up to what I want. No. No. God, I need to pray just like they need to pray. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in me like it is in heaven. In my life, at my address, in my family, in my marriage, in my job, with my children, in my finances, God, your will, not my will. That's the hard part. I pray that these words today that you put upon my heart to share with these folks will be helpful and encouraging and a blessing in their walk with you. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you once again for the opportunity to sing your praises. Lord, I just pray that as this nation continues and as this world continues, Lord, you will fulfill your promise. You said, that the increase of your government would not end. And Lord, I just pray that we as a society will continue to be conformed to the image of Christ. Lord, we want the knowledge of you to fill the earth. And Lord, you give us the opportunity to be your instruments in that cause. Lord, I pray that we would continue to be faithful to that end and preach the gospel to everyone that we see. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.